culture. I'm going to tell you a new story that's emerged that I think is really exciting, and that is when you study these individual cues, we're often missing the big picture, which is that in vivo, you're not just going to have a cell responding to something like stiffness or a cell responding to something like nanostructure. There's going to be an integration of these cues, and there's going to be a synergy and complementarity that arises. We're really excited about that. Some of our recent work has shown that biological signals, apparent and autocrine effects, can play into some of these pathways. And then finally, I'll talk a bit about some chemistry and how we can modulate stem cell differentiation using by modulating the presentation of adhesion ligands on a surface. And then I'll talk about some of our current efforts in trying to combine these things with this idea that we can incorporate multiple cues together, we can maximize the outcome that we want, and more clearly understand how cells do this naturally, as well as design the materials. And then I'll tell you, a bit of a different story, but using the same techniques is something that's recently come up where we found that patterning may be able to be used to prolong multifocal disease in stem cell culture. I'll show you a bit more about that. Okay, so today I'm primarily going to talk about the thickness of stem cells. I imagine everybody in this room has heard of these cells. So I'm not going to belabor it, but these are an exciting cell for a number of reasons. Primarily because they're a very good model system for studying stem cell biology experiments, whether that's mechanical biology or differentiation type studies, because they're relatively easy to work with. You can get them from commercial vendors these days. But in addition, they're also still a pretty exciting candidate for regenerative therapies because of the reason they can be isolated from the bone marrow as well as fat aspirates. A lot of people are using these adipose-derived stem cells. And in fact, the literature is suggesting now that these cells may be pericyte and reside on your vessel walls and could be present in every tissue throughout your body. And so this is exciting for obvious reasons, because these cells, more closely related cells that we can identify with our marker schemes, maybe in every single tissue, and they may have slight differences, but they all follow a similar set of rules to get them to regenerate tissues using standard homeostasis processes. One thing that has emerged from the use of these, particularly in clinical settings, there are a number of clinical trials underway for using these, primarily for a trophic response, where these cells are shown to secrete molecules that may promote angiogenesis, for instance. We've been investigating these, but really with the state that things are at right now, we have a difficult time controlling the way they specimen and what they turn into when they differentiate. And so really understanding the microenvironment better so that we can design better materials for therapy and things like this is important. All right, so I like to make things simple because these systems are incredibly complex, as I think everyone understands who studies biology. So when we talk about signaling in the microenvironment, there's a number of signals that we can consider. Physical signals is one that is important, and as a material scientist, we're interested in exploring some of the physical material properties, how they influence cells. So these are things like the shape of cells, the shape of tissues, how those arise, and how you may be able to manipulate cells that way. The mechanical properties, so stiffness or softness of the matrix, stretch, and we're all moving all the time, and our matrices are stretching, and strain is being put on various tissues, and this clearly has an influence on signaling. Chemical cues is my second area that I break things down into, and these include things like small molecules, but more importantly for the purpose of this talk is the precise chemical properties that you see in the extracellular matrix. So, when you have a cell sitting on top of a bed of fibronectin protein, there's a lot going on. It's not just that they're interacting with the protein, they're recognizing very distinct moieties in the ECM. So things like our friend RGD peptide that everybody in biomaterials is aware of. But there's other synergistic ligands and other ones that haven't really been fully explored that have a function. And so we're also interested in exploring what the function of these precise ligands are. I think there's a lot of room for discovering this because there's so many integrated ligands on the surface of the cell and so many different ECM proteins. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
for all sorts of markers. The result, I'll just give you the punchline, was that on the cyclic peptides, these cells would always tend to prefer to express markers associated with cell differentiation. Well, on the high-density linear peptide, we started to see expression of markers associated with biogenesis. So remember, on the intermediate stiffness gels that Engler and Fischer worked with, they showed expression of biogenesis. And here at this high density of peptide that has a lower affinity for the alpha beta 3 integrin, we started to see expression of muscle markers. And then these cells were extending out all these processes on the low density. A good fraction of them were expressing beta 3 2, which is a marker for neurogenesis. So this is that quantitative. Where here you see it's not an incredible high amount, but it is significant. Here's the RUX2 data showing that you get preferential bone marker expression in the MyoD on the high density linear peptide and beta 3 2 on the low density linear peptide. We did RT-PCR of this as well, and we got the same sort of trends when we look at the gene expression level. We see higher expression in muscle markers and neuronal markers on these linear peptides. So consider this example of stiffness, where people have been talking about for quite a while now, the importance of the material's elasticity and stiffness in direct differentiation. So from this work, it suggests that in addition to stiffness, we may be able to modulate the density and the affinity of ligands on the biomaterial to get similar trends in lineage specification. And I think this is interesting for a number of reasons, for practical reasons for biomaterial design. If you want to promote bone cell fate, have a high density of cyclic peptides. But also, I think it's interesting if you reflect on the nature of the microenvironment. If you're talking about brain tissue, you're going to have this soft material. The exposure of ligands for adhesion might be very different than if you have a very rigid calcified matrix, where you're going to have a lot more area for cells to grab onto, exert forces, and spread out. So I think in many ways this result reflects that. In addition, one thing that has become a bit of a controversy just recently, that came out in a paper just several months ago, and I was at a meeting this summer where Brad Mandler and some of the people in the office of this paper were there, and got kind of heated. And that's exciting. It's exciting when science gets turned over and gets argumentative. And I think this has been in my mind and others for a long time, that when you cross-link polyacrylamide, which is the gel that was used in this study, and you vary cross-linking density, you're not just varying stiffness, you're varying the porosity. So this is an SEM image of soft gels and stiff gels across a range of mechanical properties. So you get very different pore sizes in these materials. And if you're cross-linking your protein that the cells are going to grab onto on the surface, you look at what the cell's going to see. It's going to see a very different distribution of protein depending on what surface it's sitting on because of this porosity effect. And so I think this is interesting in light of the result that we found that by varying the spacing of these arginine peptides, you can vary the differentiation outcome. And so this may clearly play a role. And so this is a result that they found. This was a big collaboration that was done with Fiona Watt at Cambridge, as well as Bill Del Huck and Joaquin Chavez, a number of these big names. And they did this, they published this paper where using polyacrylamide, and this time they used fat bone, or fat, the soft tissue bone, and the stiff tissue. And they found that as you increase the stiffness, you get more cells, which is what others have found. But you, in terms of differentiation, you get a decrease in fat and an increase in bone. So this is expected, that as on soft materials, you'll get more fat cell differentiation. On stiff materials, you'll get more bone cell differentiation. And so this is consistent with this argument that there's lineage matching between the differentiation outcome and the mechanics of the material. But then they went and used PDMS, which doesn't have a porosity component. And they showed that when they modified PDMS, different mechanical properties, that they saw no difference in the number of cells, no difference in adipogenesis, and no difference in osteogenesis. So here they have different mechanical properties of their substrates,